Hello guys, I'm Dr. M.S. Chavan. I'm here introducing you data transmission topic. The data can be transmitted in number of ways from the source to destination. There are different modes of data transmission, which may include parallel transmission, serial transmission, asynchronous, synchronous, and isochronous communication. Along with this, another transmission modes are simplex, half duplex, and full duplex communication. Apart from these modes of communication, another concept which is very important in data communication is multiplexing of the data. Multiplexing allows more than one signal to be sent on the single transmission path, and by using the multiplexing, we can able to make effective use of transmission medium. Then we will consider parallel communication. In parallel communication, imagine that we want to transmit digital data stored as a bytes of 8 bits each, or it is stored in words of many 16 or 32 bits each, depending upon the word length. In parallel communication, we transfer the word or bytes at a time. Therefore, we need to have those many wires parallel to each other, each carrying the single bit. This is shown in the figure. Here, 8 wires are transmitting a byte at a time. In this example, the byte contains the digital information 10011001. This is a very fast method of transmitting the data from one place to another. However, there are problems in this scheme. The first problem is it is very expensive method because it requires several wires in sending as well as in receiving equipments. In addition to this, high accuracy is required, which cannot be guaranteed over long distances. Another problem is digital pulses may travel from transmitter to receiver, but with different speeds, because underlying media through which the data passes from one computer to another computer system may not have exactly same transmission characteristics, or they are not identical one. This gives a problem of skew shown in the figure. When a message is skewed, the bits 10011001 are sent from the source to destination, but they are transverse at different speeds. At the destination, the measurement of the signal values to determine whether it is 0 or 1 have to be done at the same time for all the bits. Therefore, the problem of the skew can result in inaccurate interpretation of bits. To avoid this problem, parallel transmission is used for very short distances. Here, all parallel wires have to be absolutely identical. This method is used for data transmission or communication within a computer system, such as data transmission from CPU registers to memory and vice versa. This can be done by using the data bus. The data bus R essentially implements the parallel transmission. This is done because speed rather than the cost is important in this case. However, in view of these problems outlined, this method or parallel communication method is not useful for long distances. For long distances, serial communication method is suitable. So we will look about serial communication, or we will see more details about the serial communication. Over a long distance, serial communication is used. While sending the data serially, characters or bytes have to be separated and then sent bit by bit. Thus, some hardware is needed to convert the data from parallel to serial. At the destination, the measurement of the signal values is done in the middle of the bit duration. This is shown in the figure. This is because If the values are taken at the edge or at the point where the bit value changes, the reading will be indeterminate. At the destination, all the bits are collected, measured, and put as a byte in the memory. This requires conversion from serial to parallel. The serial data transmission, we have to identify where the character starts. That is, we have to identify where the character starts. We have to also identify the middle position of each bit interval so that measurement can be taken. Normally, the transmitter and the receiver have two different clocks. The point is to synchronize the clock of the receiver exactly with that of the transmitter. When synchronized is achieved, correct reading will result and the bits values are understood correctly. This is essentially a problem of synchronization. We will take the one example of the synchronization, over the synchronization. Let us say that we have to send 8 bits B0 to B7 from X to point Y as shown in the figure. We have arranged the bits in the circular fashion to illustrate the point better. Let us say that arms A1 and A2 at the point X and Y rotate in clockwise directions. When both A1 and A2 point to the bit 1 zeros at X and Y respectively, the connection is made and the bit B0 is transferred from X to Y. Now, due to rotation, after some time, A1 will point towards the B1 at the X. At the same time, A2 also has to point to B1 at the point Y. Otherwise, the bit will not transfer correctly. The same is true for transfer of B2 through B7 bits as A1 and A2 rotate clockwise. Therefore, the two arms A1 and A2 have to be perfectly synchronized and they have to rotate at the same speed in order to succeed in sending and receiving all the bits accurately. In order to achieve this, essentially we have to adjust and synchronize the clocks of the source and destination machines. There are three ways in which this can be achieved: asynchronous, synchronous, and isochronous transmissions. A line adapter or interface generally achieves this task of synchronization. It achieves a few other things also. We'll call it only serial interface in this concept. These electronic devices called universal asynchronous receiver transmitter, that is UART, and universal synchronous asynchronous receiver transmitter, that is USART, are the examples of such interface. USART can be used for both asynchronous and synchronous transmission. On the other hand, UART is used for asynchronous transmission only. Then we will see about synchronous communication. Okay, we will see about asynchronous communication. In asynchronous communication, the time when the character will be sent cannot be predicted. In such a scenario, where the data is transmitted as a characters and at an unpredicted pace, we have to synchronize the source and destination for each character. This is called as asynchronous communication. In this case, each character is preceded with start bit and succeeded with 1.5 or 2 stop bits, which is shown in this figure. Normally, NRZL signaling is used for asynchronous transmission. According to this convention, a negative voltage denotes the binary 1 bit and the positive voltage denotes the binary 0 bit. When a line is idle, that is, when no character is being sent over a line, a constant negative voltage space signifies a binary 1 is generated. When the character is to be sent, bit 0 is sent first. This is positive voltage, which is called as a start bit. as a beat of as the beats of character, all the beats of the character according to coding scheme used, then follows, each of which could be 0 or 1 value. Then a parity bit is used, if used, follows. And lastly, in the end, 1, 1.5 or 2 stop bits are added. The stop bit again corresponds to the idle state, which is bit 1. In this context, 1.5 bits only means that the signal with negative voltage denoting 1 is generated for 1.5 times the normal bit interval. The sender and receiver have to exactly agree on the number of bits that represent the character, which may be 7 bit or 8 bit. The priority bit scheme if used, the bit interval, also what represents logical 0 and logical 1. Essentially, when the start bit is recognized by the destination, it knows that the character is being sent. It then adjusts and starts its clock so that measurement of the signal values can now start at the middle of every bit that follows for the expected number of bits. The bits in the character, including the parity bit, are measured and stored. It is expected stop bit, which is encountered if everything is okay. This is to recognize the bits being sent. This continues until the stop bit is received. At this time, the line becomes idle and the destination clock also goes to sleep. On receiving the start bit, it wakes up for the duration of that character, and after the full character is received, again goes to sleep until the next character arrives. This makes sense, fair. The rate at which the character arrives is unpredictable, and the speed at which the character are keyed is in far less than the speed with which they are transmitted or processed. There has to be a proper understanding between source and destination about the bit rate, which is measured in terms of bits per second, from which the bit interval can be computed. And this computed bit interval determines when the signal measurements have to be taken. Using this, the destination waits for the start bit and then starts its clock to measure values to recognize the bits, including parity bits. Then we'll see synchronous communication. In synchronous communication or transmission, the whole block of data bits is transferred at once. Instead of one character at a time, the block of bits may or may not consist of different characters. It could well be a digital image. It could be anything. In the latter case, we need a bit-oriented protocol between the sender and receiver. Block of bits consists of different characters. The receiver needs to know the beginning of first bit of first character. It can then start its clock and start sampling to determine the bit values. Knowing the number of bits per character, it can now recognize the character and stores them at the destination. This is shown in the figure. In this case, we need to have a bit-oriented protocol between the sender and receiver. That is the first figure here. Then at the point is, how does the receiver know the first bit of the first character or when to start the clock of sampling? In order to perform this synchronization, each data block is preceded with a unique synchronizing bit pattern, which is called as sync. That is the synchronize. Abbreviation is synchronize. Abbreviation of the synchronize is a sync. We use the sync transmission control character for this purpose. It has a bit pattern of suppose 10 or 00101010. This bit pattern is generally not used in normal communication. Therefore, this sync character can be reserved for indicating the start of the block, that is for synchronization. However, there is a problem in this scheme. The transmitter will not send a sync character as a part of the data. However, by mistake, the bit pattern of two characters could be such that if sent one after the other, they can constitute a sync character, therefore fooling the receiver. Figure shows this case. In this case, if the ASCII character B and A are sent one after another, we get a bit combination of 4 bits from a ASCII character band, 3 bits for ASCII character A, 4 bits for a bit combination of 4 bits from ASCII character band, 3 bits from the ASCII character to continue the sync character. That is 3 bits before, then sync character, and 3 bits after. At the receiving end, if receiver is all the time looking for sync character, it can get fooled. It is for this reason that normally 2 sync bytes are sent conjugatively. The bit combination of 2 sync bytes, suppose here 00 1011 000 10110, cannot be obtained by concatenating any characters. Therefore, the receiver is asked to look for 2 sync characters. If not found, it is asked to throw them off. In some systems, even 3 or 4 sync characters are sent to make sure that proper synchronization takes place. The receiver gets ready after receiving a required sync characters and then starts its clock for measuring the bit values for the actual data. This is shown in this figure. Here, discarding non-sync characters until sync is received for synchronization. Then when the clock starts measuring the bit values, the counter within the receiver is increment every as bit received and measured and pushed into the character assembler within the receiver. This is shown in this figure. After a character is assembled, the character is moved to the specific buffer and the bit counter is set to 0. And this bit counter, this setting of the bit counter, is nothing but the preparation for the next character. In the case of synchronous transmission, the equipment used at the both ends is called USART, that is Universal Synchronous Asynchronous Receiver Transmitter. This is responsible for converting the data from parallel to serial at the transmitter end and from serial to parallel at the receiver end. It is also responsible for generating the sync characters at the beginning of data blocks. Transmission and recognizing them, that is, everything is shown in this figure, where this USART is responsible for generating the sync characters at the beginning of each block before transmission and recognizing them at the receiver end, shown in this figure. Synchronous communication is used when large amount of data is to be sent from one place to another place. Synchronous transmission has obviously a much higher efficiency because it is a continuous transmission without any start and stop bits. For example, if you want to transmit a file of 100,000 characters at the rate of 9.6 kbps, The overhead extra bits for asynchronous and synchronous communication will be calculated as, for asynchronous communication, let us assume that for each character of 8 bits, one start bit and one stop bit are sent. Thus, at 2 bits per character are overhead. We will have to send an overhead of 2 bits per characters multiplied by 100,000 characters is equal to 200,000 bits. Then at the rate of 9.6 kbps per second kbps, it will take 200,000 divided by 9600 is equal to 20.83 seconds more for the overhead bits. Then in synchronous communication, we assume that the file of 100,000 characters is broken into blocks of 1200 characters. That is equal to 9600 bits. We will assume that 48 overhead bits are sent along each block. For sync, start of transmission STX and end of transmission ETX and other characters. The overhead is now computed as follows. The number of blocks is equal to 100,000 divided by 1200 is equal to 250 divided by 3 blocks. The number of overhead bits is equal to 250 divided by 3 multiplied by 48, that is 4000 bits. The time taken to send overhead bits at this rate, that is 9600 bps, is the 4000 divided by 9600 seconds is equal to 0.4167 seconds. Thus, the time taken for asynchronous communication is much higher, in this case 50 times higher. Then next is isochronous communication. In this method, or this method combines the approaches of asynchronous and synchronous communications. In this method, as in asynchronous method, each character has both the start and stop bits. However, the idle period between the two characters is not random. For instance, all idle periods of no transmission consist of an exact multiple of one character time interval. Therefore, if the time to transmit character, including its parity, start and stop bits, to transmit character is T. Suppose if the time to transmit character is T, the time interval between characters cannot be random as in asynchronous method. It is also not zero as in synchronous method. It has to be T, 2T, 3T, like this, where n is a positive integer. Here up to nT we can take, where n is a positive integer in isochronous communication. The figure shows the difference between these three approaches. The main reason for using isochronous method to asynchronous method is speed. In practice, asynchronous transmission is limited to data rate of 2400 bits per second according to precision of timing in transmitting and receiving modems. By contrast, isochronous transmission can achieve the data rates up to 19200 bits per second. This is about type of transmission modes used for digital data transmission from transmitter to receiver. Thank you.